Another self-destructive and occult-related activity that has been popularized by rock music is drug abuse. It is stating the obvious to say that drugs are everywhere in rock, from the ravaged bodies of the stars to the lyrics of their songs. The Beastie Boys' best-selling album, License to Ill, for example, contains over 90 references to drugs and alcohol abuse. What is not as well known, however, is drugs' connections to the spiritual realm. Psychotropic or mind-altering substances are viewed by sorcerers and others involved in the occult as a gateway or a guide into the spirit world. The Greek word in the scriptures for sorcery, in fact, is pharmakeia, from whence we get our words pharmacy or pharmaceuticals, in other words, drugs. Their use is a form of sorcery. The high that is drugs' primary attraction is unquestionably a spiritual experience, one that opens the user up to the spirit world. Likewise, a rock magazine described The Cure's Robert Smith's creative process as follows. He often comes up with his most macabre ideas for songs in the nightmares he experiences while sleeping off alcoholic binges. The entire album, The Head on the Door, was written under those conditions. Over the years, the Grateful Dead have become almost synonymous with marijuana and LSD use. A national newspaper described the uncanny fascination they inspire in their devoted fans. For many of the camp followers, the Dead are a religion and their lyrics a Bible. It is generally accepted that the Dead are tapped into some profound LSD-inspired truth. Not surprisingly, some hallucinating Deadheads have weaved weird and elaborate theories about God and the universe from strands of Grateful Dead lyrics. It's not surprising because the Dead themselves have acknowledged this drug-induced transcendence. As Captain Trips, Jerry Garcia, said in their biography, Playing in the Band, I can't deny that there's a moment when I'm transformed, when all of a sudden God is speaking through my strings. As many rock artists like Garcia have entered middle age, they've had to break their addictions to drugs in order to survive. A few have recorded testimonials for RAD, Rock Against Drugs. A classic case of too little, too late. For most, their warning cries sound hollow.
We don't need drugs. We got rock and roll.
Yeah.
Rock and roll's our high.
Yeah.
How can you be against something that your philosophy and lifestyle give rise to? For example, Bon Jovi has done a spot for RAD while maintaining their hedonistic message. And their powerful hit video, Wanted Dead or Alive, contains a not-so-subtle endorsement for the most abused drug of all, alcohol.
Sometimes you tell me by the bottle that you drink.
Ultimately, comedian and rock devotee Sam Kennison's criticism of Rock Against Drugs says it all. It's like Christians against Christ. Rock created drugs.
This embrace of the occult has led to a curious phenomenon described in the Bible. The light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. Where people in their fallenness move beyond rejecting light and loving darkness, and come to the place where they are fascinated with and even love death and hell itself. For example, besides riding the serpent and mainstreaming the venom of the do-what-thou-wilt worldview, Rock and Roll Hall of Famer Eric Burdon has also come face to face with the spiritual entities that slither beneath the surface. His entree to this occult world, like so many other rockers, was through the doorway of pharmakeia, the sorcery that is psychotropic drugs. In his autobiography, he described an LSD trip he took with Andy Summers, guitarist for The Police. As he stared at a Hindu mural created by Summers, focusing on the figure of Kali, the goddess of death and destruction, he fell into a deep coma. Then I came face to face with Kali, Burdon remembered. I was covered in a void. Darkness, darkness. Ah, so you need answers, said Kali. If you want information, you have to make me a gift. You've taken my sight, Burdon responded. What more do you want? She laughed a wicked, cruel laugh in the darkness. how much are you willing to give? My life, I said. My life was sucked out of me. I was gonzo, melted to the floor, dead. Compare this with the testimony of a student at Columbia University after she took part in an occult ritual led by Dr. Michael Harner, an anthropologist and practicing shaman.
I went down a couple of levels and then went even further to some area that was very gray and slimy and foggy, and I walked through that for a while and found another opening and went down even further. It was someplace I'd never been before, and it was kind of like a cave, and there were some beings in there, but I couldn't quite make out what they were. And I was just kind of sitting there with them, and all of a sudden they came at me with knives and tore me apart into all these pieces and tore my flesh off. I was startled, but it didn't hurt.
And finally, there's the testimony of rock and roll's most focused, committed, and articulate neo-pagan, Genesis Peoridge. In the occult magazine Gnosis, he enthusiastically described a life-changing experience he underwent in Nepal when he became the first Westerner to be invited into a particular shrine to the Hindu god Shiva. Then this priest anointed me with this tilak, Peoridge remembered, and I got this really fast freeze frame of the shrine, animal intestines, and mummified human heads, and incredibly powerful, very dark-edged materials, pools of blood, and it was really dark, and he started chanting. As soon as he started chanting, it was like Terence McKenna described DMT. I just went, woo, instantly into this completely altered vortex, shooting into this deeper and deeper blackness, floating in liquid blackness, the ultimate blackness, black beyond black. And then I became really aware that somewhere within this ultimate black were these two shiny, slightly pointed, almost insectoid eyes. Shiva watched. After years of studying the occult traditions of Crowley and Austin Osman Spare, of ingesting powerful psychotropics and practicing sex magic, ritual cutting, tattooing and piercing, cross-dressing, filing his teeth, presenting occultic and obscene performance art, playing the techno shaman, putting the satanic Enochian calls to music, and relentlessly blaspheming God, Peoridge was finally ready to come face to face with the spirit behind it all. And he consciously did what so many others do unconsciously. He embraced the darkness.
Continuing with our examination of the byproducts of rock and roll, consider one of its greatest themes, rebellion.
Then there's that spark. There's that rebellious spark, which is what rock is.
For Blackie Lawless of Wasp, it goes even deeper. As he told the Washington Post, rock and roll is an aggressive art form, pure hostility and aggression. I believe in that like a religion. For I stand forth to challenge the wisdom of the world, to interrogate the laws of man and God. He who saith thou shalt to me is my mortal foe. The rebellion spoken of here is not the honest and vital revolt of good against evil and truth against lies, but rebellion steeped in evil, anarchistic, hypocritical, and ultimately destructive. It's not an exaggeration to say that rebellion is more than just an occasional theme in rock. It is its very heart and soul. As Rolling Stone magazine proudly noted in its 20th anniversary television special,
fire to the bone.
And that's what rock and roll ought to be. The kids ought to come up and just hit you right in the face. I don't mean breaking noses, but I mean with what it is they have to say, and dressing different so that adults are going, oh, God, yeah, that's it, you know. Make them throw up. Yeah.
Now when I walk the streets, kings and queens step aside. Every woman I meet, they all stay satisfied. I want to tell you, pretty baby, what I see, I'll make my own. And I'm here to tell you, honey, that I'm bad to the bone.
Some people say this music is loud, stupid, excessive, vulgar, and appeals to the basest animal instincts. That's why we play it.
I don't know. I think music, really, it's supposed to be like a feeling. It's usually about like youth culture, totally rebelling.